This
That's about
conference will now be recorded.
Difference to people around the globe. Now, when the architecture or infrastructure of internet is being established, all we are doing is just building on top of it, where we are telling that now it's time where we connect things rather than we connect humans. What these things are, basically, these things could be some small things, which is like temperature measurement, your humidity, your noise, gas sensor, or maybe like water measurement or flow meter, like small things. And these could also be autonomous things, which is your independent things, such as your self-driving car. You need to know the precise location of the car. You need to know the live video, what that car is looking at. So in case of emergency, you can actually press a kill switch and hence prevent any death or any mishappening. So that means there are like small and autonomous things, and there are like big things, such as your cooker robot, and there are like big trucks, and those trucks which are carrying like 1 ton or 2 tons of load in the back, in the carriage, and they travel around like 100 kilometers or even 1,000 kilometers, which is quite possible in the region of Europe, where every country in Europe Union is connected. All you need is just a resident card in Europe. So truck transport the goods from mainly the goods import in hub is Poland, Czech Republic, and Germany. So from there they carry the load from this place to another city. And you can connect literally even things which are in the middle, for example, those services that provide you transfer of post from one place to another, your post, and things like that. So anything you can think of, you can control over internet and get the location of it. Why this internet control things are important? You can see in this visualization that there is a truck that is transmitting some kind of data. Maybe it could be the speed of that truck or the GPS location of the truck. And why this basic sensors are important? For example, there is a very serious crisis all over the world where tortoises are being exchanged in black market, which is something very serious issue. So the forensic department of every country try to make sure that these tortoises or animals are not traded off in the black, or they're not bought, or they've not been cut, or even to sharks. I'm quite a bit of environmentalist, so I'm going to talk about a bit of environment issues. So those sharks, what they do, people who hunt sharks, all they do shark hunting is just to cut their fins, and they just leave those sharks in the water to die. So imagine that such a serious thing is happening in the world. Not just that, countries like Korea or China or Japan, they trap the blue whales, and the blue whales are like endangered species. They're like few in the world, and they trap that with big arrows. And if you watch the videos on YouTube, you will see that how brutal it is to catch those big whales. All they do with catching those blue whales is they are just test. That's it. Test if their components or their body parts are used for some medical purposes, and everything is in place, or just for partying. So I think these things are very important to note about. So if researchers, scientists, or you as aspiring engineers can take this IoT technology in order to propose a solution which is good for forensic department, for environmentalists, to track down animals that are being hunted for just for amazement, I think we engineers can bring a bigger impact in this world. Another thing, dolphins, and they are used for just for fun. So that means you just put the dolphin in some cage in some water park, and then they're tortured to do things that makes you feel fun. That means these things are very important issues to talk about. So whenever we build a project during a class, when you come or by yourself, whenever you do this as a project, you take down in mind that these are the issues that need to be touched, and you need to do something related that brings the change in the environment, brings the impact in the environment. So now talking about this IoT, when we can control everything, we can also have access to the internet, where the devices are, where the animals are, where the humans are, where your heart count and things like that. So they are like the different technologies that people talk about when they talk about Internet of Things, which is machine to machine, IIoT, IoT, Internet of Everything, Web of Things, Industry 4.0. Now, I can just disambiguate things. This industrial IoT is a sub-branch of IoT, and you can have a look on this this chart. It depicts that in order to have a reach from machines to the real world, and also in the x-axis, you can see how the scope is as respect to virtual world to the physical world. So that means these things, this Industry 4.0 or industrial IoT is nothing but it's just to make your computer, your devices, your real world examples or real world devices as smart as possible. So for example, if you talk about an industrial Internet of Things, they talk about, when you talk about IIoT, they scale this Internet of Things of small devices to industrial Internet of Things to big devices such as giant motors, giant turbines in hydroelectric power plants, or like they scale up things to big machines. So when you control those machines with some power requirements, with their possibility of getting worn out and predictive maintenance, that's where you call that industrial Internet of Things. And when you incorporate things like augmented reality, virtual reality, in order to control these things and make them secure, so that's where you come to the level of Industry 4.0. I hope you are aware of, now you are comfortable with the concept, what is IoT. Can I have a few yes? Can I know what other things can you control with the internet? Can I have some reply in the chat? After speaking about some of the things that is possible to control and track and monitor them, what things can you imagine of you feel like this is an important issue to be touched in society so that we can track down and leverage Internet of Things and make it impactful in the world? So Vishal says home automation. Great. I would be happy if you guys can a little bit elaborate in a sentence saying maybe I can control devices or let's say disabled people or those who are not able to walk properly or old people. So Akshay says overflowing garbage dump, that's good, impactful. So if the garbage overflows, there is chances for disease. Control medical activities, especially in present scenario, it will be kept and amid COVID-19. Medical activity, could you please elaborate what are you trying to hit, Sana? R3 says switch on and off light and fans from a distance, car automation. That's a good basic application of it. That's a good application. And you can create an impact where you can bring down the operation cost of every home, and hence if the homes are smart, so they don't have to generate a lot of power at the generation station. Aditya says overflowing of water from the tap. Yes, that's a good one. Automatic sketching machine. Ayushi, sketching machine. What do you want to do with sketching machine? Can you elaborate? Abhishek says overload electricity. I think it's more relevant to home automation or maybe scale up one. Weather and AQI monitoring using several nodes in particular cities. What you would like to do with the weather monitoring, but it's a good way of using Internet of Things. Good. Pooja says traffic management. Traffic management, can you please elaborate? Maybe I know of it, but I want you to elaborate our things about that. Sana says, I need to say that by technical apparatus and medical instruments. Yeah, you can control through some level. Yeah, that's a good one. Monitoring human brain. Prasen says monitoring human brain. What do you want to monitor in human brain? Charan Preet says basic data of water level and definition of water. Yes, that's a good one. That's a good one to monitor the how dirty the water is, contamination in the water. Sketch the image using machine. You can do that by a robot, maybe from the pick and place or like some AI algorithm. Irrigation and farm, that's a good one. Anurag, it's a good one. Irrigation and farm. When you join in the course, there will be an implementation of use case study related to irrigation by using MQTT. So you're free to come. Gas leakage system, yes, that's a good one. There was a serious tragedy about gas recently. Manage, maybe you can put that into and leverage it wherever, let's say, emergency gas leakage, and you can alarm people or people around so that they can just run away from their home, something like that. Manage traffic and accident. Yeah, Pooja, it's a good one too. Fire alarms, sending information directly to fire stations, a good one. That's happening in Portugal too. Abhishek, to control speed of vehicles. I think yes, you can control the speed of, maybe you can leverage it in a way where someone overspeeds, so you send the data to nearby police station and they get the warning. Or maybe you integrate with camera and then they can take a snap. Biometric cybersecurity scanners, that's specific one. And yeah, I think level, if you can explain, it will be good for everyone. Water distribution in different areas, good one. Detecting abnormality of brain using the brain wave. But we have something called MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI, frequency magnetic resonance imaging for that. Maybe if you're specific, you can elaborate. Managing traffic, yeah. Monitoring your home, fine. I got basic idea which you presented. Yeah, great, thank you. Smart grid in the city, great. Traveler's car, yeah. Could you please provide more detail about IoT in web? Yeah, okay, no problem. Manhole treatment. What is that, manhole treatment? Aditya says monitoring number of corona patients in city. Maybe someone can just, yeah, in a way you can just send the data. Let's say I am COVID-19 positive and you can display the chart online. Intrusion detection system, IDS. What do you mean by IDS? Unique ID to each people so that in place like mall, monuments could easily locate it, safety for them and flash conditions. In a way, yeah. But whenever you provide IT variables and CVC equipment, yeah, good. So before you propose a solution, you make sure that whenever you propose a solution to a company, so for example, if you're proposing a solution to me and I'm an investor, so you need to really, so as of now, it's fine. Everyone has a good idea. So whenever you propose a solution, make sure you don't just propose something that you think is good. Maybe you have to detail the existing problem, just like I presented, like there is a situation in our environment where the animals are given, like they are not monitored and they're just bought and sold in black market, and it's illegal also because they're endangered because we cannot save them. So if you describe the problem first and give the solution how you, with the help of IoT, this will make more impactful for your company, for your professors who are going to monitor your or evaluate your IoT solution. And that's how your solution becomes more perfect. Okay. And someone says, could you please elaborate IoT on web? So IoT in web, so a general architecture of IoT consists of IoT cloud. You have gateway such as your router and you have end devices. Now, whenever you talk about IoT on web, we have those devices that you want to control or you want to monitor on website. So for example, you can just transmit some kind of data. So guys, can you hear me? Yeah. So these devices, you can basically control over internet and get the data online. And with web, basically, I mean, when you have HTTP interaction with IoT devices, that's wherein you can use IoT on web. Okay. Now, a general architecture of Internet of Things, you can see here, you have cloud layer, you have fog layer, you have edge layer. Before, like sometime before, there was nothing called fog layer, but in order to reduce the computation on cloud or at edge, and make cloud less, because whenever you deploy a cloud solution, it's very expensive. Because even though they say that it's just 0.05 per minute or per hour, whenever you just leave the system on cloud, it's like $1,000 or $2,000. And you cannot really afford to propose your clients about this expensive price. Okay, so you have to keep in mind such things. So you hence is the reason why fog layer was incorporated before with cloud and edge layer. So this fog layer helps in performing some kind of analysis or getting the data, perform some data cleaning and things like that. And those devices, what devices can you bring in fog layer is basically your Raspberry Pi. I guess you guys might have heard of it. And edge devices could be something like your Arduino. And I'm going to talk about how to choose the best Arduino for your next application. Okay. And whenever you talk about cloud computing, you have distributed network, like decentralized network. And if you don't know about decentralization, this is how the Indian government works. And Indian government is one of the biggest decentralized government systems. So you have one parliament, you have one PM, you have one president, and each state has their own CM. So that's a decentralized network. No one person has a control over everything. Okay. And you can collect the data and get it accessible any part of the world. And you also have 24/7 and quite cheaper, but not very cheaper as compared to your other solutions. So, I mean, cheaper in a sense that if your system failures occur, the system failures or maintenance of it is done by the cloud service provider, let's say AWS, Azure, and Google, and you don't have to hustle into this. You have fog and edge computing. It brings intelligent creation of the data at the site of where the data is being generated. And this fog layer acts as a layer between edge and you know that. So for example, you have single board computer, Raspberry Pi, ROG Pi, you have BeagleBone, Intel Edison, Intel Julia. These are from their lower computation to higher computation on high-end devices that are used industrially. Now, Raspberry Pi is more of a prototyping board, which we use in our training and of IoT devices. Now, this edge computing are the source of data. These are typically your microcontrollers, such as your low constraint devices. Whenever I talk about constraint devices, these are constrained in a way that they have less flash memory. They have less code space. So you can just code very less amount of code. And they have like ADC on their restrictions in all of this. And you have all this from cloud to in a different perspective or in a different depiction. You can view this cloud to this end devices. And you have different and this is one of those. It also shows you that you can see at the left side of this image, you have large volume of data, you have wide variety of data such as your camera, and you also have high velocity. And these three features together constitute what is known as big data. So big data features are that the data is large, you have wide variety of data, and you have high velocity of data. And then these all data passes through routers and switches, and you have this fog layer, and then you have cloud layer. So you need to have a smart system, you need to have algorithms or your data pipeline, which cleans the data and performs the analysis at the cloud. And all you need to send the data is just the report or something like a general report system to the cloud. Someone says, sir, is cloud a one-time investment? I think yes, yeah, cloud is one-time investment. You don't need to worry about it. But one-time investment, if you mean that you just pay fixed amount and you get free, no. It's about pay-per-use. So how much amount of data you use, that much amount of charges you will be charged with. But of course, AWS being the one of the tech giants, it offers you most of its solution as free, and most of your data is free. So for example, if you're trying to have a solution which is like a small data, so in a way you have some free version of it, you can use it. But when these charges they are beneficial to AWS. Whenever there is a company called oil tankers, they have to travel and they have to transmit the data in the ship. So that is where these cloud service provider are in benefit, rather than just small scale devices that we deploy them for. So there is some issue. I just want to take a 3 minutes break because I'm just trying to set up my laptop towards. So there's a power issue at my place. And those of you who are going to or are interested to work in IoT using for electricity domain, kindly please make do something about electricity, because those people who steal electricity, because of them we are not able to have power for forever. Okay, so please do something about electricity, and I'll be very grateful for that. Okay, so next, moving forward, okay, in order to make this realization of IoT and sending the data, there are different protocols. Now, before this, I really wanted to take, I hope you guys don't mind, I will take you to the rough notes or the raw notes that I've maintained for myself. And it's also good for you before giving you about communication and about these Wi-Fi and 4G light, I want to take you to the protocols that are responsible for this device or data transmission between end devices to the cloud. So Rahul Rujul, I think yes, you will be giving the you will be given about the recording. And I'm going to share you my rough notes. So let's go to my sure. So that's my notebook. Okay. I hope you guys can see that. Yeah. I hope you guys can see this. Yeah, okay. So, Sanath, we won't be talking about Sigfox or LoRaWAN in this network because of time constraint, we can't just really go in depth of it. But I can give you those companies that are implementing Sigfox. It is ST microcontrollers that have Sigfox enabled. And these are only available as of now in Europe or some part of maybe America, but not in India so far because of their implementation level. But LoRa and LoRaWAN is being implemented, and the only company that is implementing it as of now is Zenra. That is, Zenra is also part of IoT LoRa Alliance, which basically gives the guidelines about how to implement LoRa. So Sigfox is not in India as of now, and you still need a lot of time. Yeah, ST is implementing LoRa. Yes, they have possibility. There are many companies now, they are implementing LoRa devices. That's not an issue now. The only reason why ST is implementing this Sigfox is because most of its clients is also in Europe. So that's the reason. So I want to talk about the protocol. These give you an overview about cloud computing. So let's say these studies have shown that the cloud computing has potential to satisfy many IoT requirements. And before going to that, there are some requirements for IoT architecture. So for example, whenever you talk about IoT, you have to keep in mind that your resource will be constrained. Your resource or your data will be gathered by a constrained device, as I spoke about that. The reason is you have to make the device work forever. So you can't just go on every next day or every week and just try to upload the code, or maybe try to change the battery, or maybe try to maintain the code, because it is practically not possible. And whenever you talk about IoT, you have to talk about scale-up projects which has at least, if not thousands of devices that are acquiring a lot of data. Okay, so you can just send your site engineer and say, change the battery or do this and do that. So you have to keep those devices or end devices as those which consumes less power, have security, privacy, Yeah, possibility to communicate with wireless or different networks. I'll talk about that later on. And most importantly, they are constrained in all factors. There are some protocols that are standardized. So you have AccuRoute, AMQP, XMPP, DDS, HTTP, and CoAP. And this, I'm going to take you about from HTTP, CoAP to AccuRoute, and I'll keep AMQP, XMPP, and DDS for our course, where you, when you join, I'll explain you and I'll give you a live webinar or live implementation of MQTT or AMQP or XMPP, and you will see how differently you can use these protocols and make your project more unique. Okay. So cloud, these basically support AMQP because they can have interaction between them for their technical reason about that. And based on interaction model, there are two types of protocols existing as of now, which is a request, reply, and publish and subscribe. And request and respond are kind of a client server model, while your publish and subscribe is like your client and broker model, like client server. They both are client server, but then one of it is centralized and another one is decentralized. That means broker in publish subscribe doesn't have the authority to control everything or the logs of it or things like that. All the commonality between HTTP broker and MQTT broker is about their routing of messages. So the server in HTTP request also requests from database, and even in a publish subscribe model, they have a broker. So you have HTTP and CoAP being the most common request and reply protocol. And in this visual diagram, you can see you have different versions of HTTP. If anyone of you is background from web development, you know whenever you define your headers, you define HTTP 1.1 or HTTP 1.0 or HTTP 2. So there is a difference between these three things, and I'm going to talk about this. So this, so in HTTP 1.0, the TCP connection is closed after single HTTP request. That means every time you try to get the data from the server or the database, you need to have a new connection. But in HTTP 1.1, you have keep alive mechanism. And whenever, let's say, a TCP connection could be refused for multiple requests. But then in this, once the request, you can have, like, say, I can just show you. Yeah, so once the requests are sent, the browser starts listening for the responses. That means you have it like a waiter. Like a client who is waiting for the browser to start sending the message from the server itself. And then you have HTTP 2.0 that makes it more of a multiplexing, and it can be sent responses asynchronously while TCP connection. And since HTTP 2.0 is not very standardized, so people are still using HTTP 1.1. Now the subscribe model is more of a distributed asynchronous and loosely coupled. That means a publisher and subscriber don't need to really be bounded in order to exchange the data. There are some benefits about it, for sure. You have public subscribers. They don't really need to know the existing of each other. And you have one subscriber can receive information from different publishers. And also you can also have one publisher sending data to multiple subscribers. So they don't really need to know how many publishers or subscribers are there. So it's kind of a many-to-many protocol. Now talking about, so we can just classify there are publish and subscribe based protocol, which is MQTT and AMQP. Request reply only is HTTP, but those protocol which has a possibility to implement publish subscribe and request are HTTP, are your CoAP, XMPP, and HTTP 2.0. Now there are other protocols also. For example, you have real-time protocols such as WebRTC. And me and my mentee, who I mentor basically as a part of my mentoring session, we are working on using this protocol, let's say MQTT, AMQP, or WebRTC in order to implement live video conferencing or chatting or things like that. So we have this project ongoing. And so in a way, I'm just trying to motivate you that if you're interested to come join this course, you also get to the possibility of implementing or being a part of this project of live video conferencing implementation. Okay. Or maybe also your chatting application. So, and also MQTT is used by Facebook to some extent. So I'll explain you about other things also. So HTTP is basically a CRUD, create, read, update, delete, which can be implemented by using post, get, put, and delete. I hope many of you could know. But then you have these machines being able to talk with each other with the help of JSON or XML data formatting. Whenever I talk about data formatting, it's about how I try to talk with you. So for example, I have Sagar, and I tell Sagar that, hey Sagar, I just raise my hand and say, hey, what's your name? So I have a format of saying or asking Sagar that, or since I don't know Sagar's name, I would say name, what's your name? So Sagar would implement his mind saying that, okay, the person is asking me my name. So this is the format of the data. And then he will respond in the similar data format saying, my name is Sagar. So that's how the JSON XML data formatting is. And then you have typical HTTP. You have how your HTTP get and post request is. Basically, if you imagine something called your Gmail account, if you're trying to create your Gmail account, it's more of a post request where you're telling the server that you can update my username, email, and password and update the database. So that's your post request. And whenever you try to access the data, for example, if you're just trying to sign in, it's more of a get request. So that means you're trying to get the resources from the server or database. Okay. Now, in order to evaluate this HTTP protocol, and this is very important whenever you're an IT engineer, so you need to evaluate every protocol in order to realize why a different protocol or the next protocol is better than this one. So since HTTP uses TCP and TCP, quick question. Does anyone know about TCP? What is the difference between TCP and UDP protocol? Quick. Fire experts or network people or electronics engineer or network engineers. What is the difference between TCP and UDP? And if you don't know, I can give you a hint. Does anyone know about what is the difference between TCP and UDP? UDP is faster. Great. Yes, it's faster. And I'll explain you why is it faster. Yeah, UDP is connectionless. Great. Good. And anyone else? No? Okay. So TCP and UDP protocols is basically, TCP is connection oriented. Yes. Yeah. So TCP is more of a handshake protocol, while UDP is just like send the data and forget and forgive. Okay. So whenever you have protocols based on TCP, it makes sure that the data is being transferred from the senders to the receiver. So that's the minimum requirement of TCP. But UDP is just like it takes the ball and throws in the air and just take another ball and throw in the air. So people have to just run here and there and then get the ball. Okay. And because of that, UDP helps you in order to have full duplex connection. And then TCP is just like request and response. Like you cannot just have live talking in TCP based protocol. And hence you can see those protocols. So having this TCP and UDP overview, that means TCP can have only one person speaking and wait for another person to respond. That's like half duplex connection. But then UDP is your full duplex connection. That means both of you can talk with each other together. So what do you think? Is your video conferencing TCP based or UDP based? Quick. What do you think your TCP? Oh, TCP, really? Can you not have can you not talk with each other live? And can you not share your video? Yeah, great. Vishal, Anurag, Aditya, Abhishek, great, UDP. Yeah, sure, UDP. So we are using UDP-based protocol in order to implement this live video conferencing using React framework and things like that. Great. So now you guys have knowledge about what protocol is being used in background of this video conferencing. So and don't worry, this implementing video conferencing is not a rocket science. It's very easy. You have this framework and you need to integrate with that. Okay. Coming back to evaluating HTTP protocol, it's TCP based. So that means it will take time. And since TCP adds more headers to it, because it needs to know the person who is sending the data and it needs to know the person who is accepting the data. So that means it has overhead of it. And then if you need to implement secure protocol, you have TLS support. Now, with this overhead, the trade-off comes is that you have high power consumption in HTTP protocol, and it doesn't really explicitly define QoS level because it's based on TCP protocol. Now, you have power requirement, more power requirement. That means by default, you cannot use this protocol in the end devices, right? I hope you guys agree that we cannot use HTTP for end nodes, or can we? Because it takes more power and it's based on TCP. So TLS is transport layer security. It's a digital certificate that makes two endpoints, connection and handshake, secure. So the data is being encrypted, and those only who has that digital certificate will be able to get the data. So I hope you guys know about that. Can we use HTTP in end devices? Let's say our Arduino, can we use HTTP? Will it be beneficial to use that? It takes more power. So will you be willing to use a protocol that takes more power, or will you be interested in taking implementing protocol that takes less power?
Less power.
Okay. And it also takes time. So it's not necessary whenever you type google.com, MQTT is preferred. So yeah, we will use less power for sure. So going back to next protocol, which is CoAP, and the good thing about why I took CoAP from HTTP is because CoAP is based on RESTful environment. That means you can always have request and response, just like your HTTP. You have GET, POST, all these requests. But it supports like HTTP protocol, and it is also a lightweight protocol. That means it has less header, and also it will be taking less power. But it runs over less complex UDP. So that means this has more advantage over end devices. So you can use this in your web browser rather than using HTTP. Now, there are clauses with it, or there are like trade-off with it. So since it is implementing being on UDP, so that means definitely it is not really preferred, right? Because UDP does not make sure that the data is being sent, right? So CoAP basically is implemented to target this issue. CoAP is implemented on two layers. One is your HTTP RESTful, and the other layer is basically your message layer, which has four messages. That is your CON, confirmable, non-confirmable, acknowledgement, and reset. And the CON messages are used to ensure for reliable communication. So that means, in a way, you can use CoAP and implement your IoT end device on internet. And since the type of CoAP URL that you have is like your CoAP, CoAPS:// and then the www dot whatever website you have. So it's like the header is the URL is something similar to HTTP. But the downside, let's evaluate this, okay? So UDP-based protocol comes with a reliability of trade-off that hence the CoAP, it's basically a UDP-based protocol, but since we know that it has a message layer, so we are sure that the message will be sent. Now, DTLS, although it's not designed for IoT, the only con or the less better point in CoAP is basically DTLS is not optimized to be used for IoT devices. That means if you start making your data or your communication secure by using DTLS, you will have headers and hence more power. So that means the work is being done on DTLS to make it optimized for IoT. But then you can still use it if you don't care about the headers and things like that. But it's still better than your HTTP request. Okay. So HTTP versus CoAP, which one would you prefer for IoT? Quick response.
CoAP. So CoAP.
So HTTP versus CoAP. Great. So yeah, people use that for end device communication.
Because it provides some security via DTLS, right?
Now, I know when I talk about this protocol, which is our last topic about discussion of protocol, which is MQTT, most of your hearts will be broken because MQTT is way better than CoAP and HTTP. It's lightweight protocol. It is optimized for resource constrained devices. It is optimized for low bandwidth, but it has high latency. That means how much time it takes from data from server to reach to the client. That's your latency. And if you want to compete with MQTT, you need to have, in terms of latency, you have a protocol called WebRTC, which is like 500 milliseconds of low latency level. But still, when you compare with HTTP and CoAP, it's quite faster than those, and it's less overhead, so it's better. And it runs on TCP, so that means you will have confirmation of it. With light header, it comes with much lower power requirements. And this is how the public architecture of this MQTT protocol is. So one is broker, the broker and client communicate by publishing the data, and the client, which is subscribing the data, is able to get it. High latency and lower power consumption are the major advantages, yes. And it needs a client and broker in order to communicate. They are open source broker, RabbitMQ, HiveMQ, ActiveMQ. It can store some messages if you tell the broker to store some messages. It uses TCP, so it is critical for constrained devices. Let's say kind of an evaluation. But in order to use MQTT for sensor network, since you are using TCP, there is a protocol which is MQTT SN, which is your sensor network. Now this protocol is based on UDP, so that means you get the benefit of using less overhead protocol with UDP based protocol, which is like throw the ball and then it's quite fast and connectionless. So then you have but the con part of it is only few platforms have implemented MQTT SN, and the only free broker existing is really small message broker. Except that no. No, the broker is there for the yeah. And if you want to evaluate that, it doesn't provide encryption at within itself. Let's say you don't have encryption level if you barely implement MQTT. But you can, of course, create a cryptography. You can import cryptography library, and you can secure the data, send the data, and decrypt or decode and things like that. Sorry. And data has been exchanged with plain text. So it's an issue. So that means you can, of course, as I said, cryptography is a solution. And encryption using TLS, which also increases the overhead of it. That means although there is, you can implement secure level of MQTT, but then also it comes with the overhead. That means it will make it more to slow and bit of like time taking by implementing it. So which one is being used considering the security standard in industries? So only few, I know of the few clients, very few people who are doing CoAP. They are promoting CoAP, maybe because they have expertise in CoAP and they want to give development over CoAP, and they are suggesting CoAP protocol. And most of the people are using MQTT. Most of the people are using MQTT because it's standardized, and even Facebook uses MQTT in its messenger. So to some part, not completely, but some part. Cryptography an issue for MQTT? No, I have used cryptography along with encoding the data and then decrypt it or decode it. So it's not an issue. But of course, when you in cryptography, is like it comes with the overhead of, let's say, your 256-bit encryption. It depends what kind of encryption you want to use. 125 or 126, 125 bits or 256 bits, It depends on which type of cryptography or AES and encryption you want to get. Okay, so it's completely up to you. But then 256 is much more like you cannot, it takes a lot of time in order to break down the message by 256 encryption. Okay, but then when you have TLS, your connection is anyway secure also. So TLS gives you security over connection, your network. Okay. I hope you have now gathered, how many of you, can we have quick yes, that you have gathered the overview and much knowledgeable part of it from MQTT, HTTP and CoAP after this? Great, Akshay says yes. Great. Yeah. So that's the importance, that's the target of this. That I want to give you more of a in-depth of it, where you have something to learn from this webinar. And even though it's unpaid, but then you should always have something to take away from a webinar, not just repeating some old stuff and then giving you everything. Let me just go back to our previous presentation that I was showing you. There I have. Yeah, it's here. Yeah, so now we have come back to our device. So now you know how these devices use this data protocol, message protocol, or network protocol in order to exchange the data. And there is like classification, let's say, there is a classification based on automation, based on electronic devices. So in industrial automation, people use OPC UA. There's not much difference between it, but since it's a protocol designed for industrial automation, so people use OPC UA. Someone says, can you tell again which has best encryption? It depends. Like, as per researchers, some people say 256-bit AES encryption is something like it takes forever to decode it. Because for AES encryption, you need to have a secure key, let's say your key, that kind of a password. So the length of that password is 32 bits. And even if you use brute force in order to decode that password, like different combination of it, so you will take like millions of years in order to break that. And whenever a new protocol encryption is made, it is made in a mindset of, let's say, 50 or 100 years. Because as per one of the researchers, he says that in order to decode AES in encryption, you need to have like supercomputers sit for it for a long time and then try to be on brute force. And even then, there's like, by the time there will be something like 500 or 480, some encryption will be already available. Okay. And on top, you also have TLS security, which is your transfer layer security. If you provide 2048 bits of encryption, so if the hacker doesn't have that digital certificate, he won't be able to get the data. Okay. So he can't do anything with that. And of course, I mean, I haven't met a hacker. I mean, you cannot really tell yourself that you're a cyber expert unless you meet a hacker and live safeguard your network with respect to he. Because those hackers are like your thief. They're like brutal. They just take anything and break your stuff, break your security and go. Whereas police or the cybersecurity expert has some protocols to follow. You cannot just take the hammer and then beat the hacker and say, oh, bloody, don't do that again or something like that. Okay. So these people are like wrong. So one of the organizations, if you guys know, is something called Anonymous, who are a secret organization, and they have literally barged in, or they have literally gone into the system of US security forces, Pentagon and things like that, and then export all the documents for whenever they need. So as for them, they are like savior of internet control devices or internet enabled devices or information. So they jump in whenever there is some kind of happening in the world. They just try to make themselves like a hero, and then they jump in, try to expose stuff, and then make it public to internet. And they also give a live challenge to the terrorist organization, saying that you will be exposed by us. So they're like a savior of internet. That's what they claim. But government says they are illegal. So guys, those who have Can you please mute your mic? Not good. I think it's good now. Yeah, okay. Now, when we know about encryption, we know about communication protocols or message protocols, we need to know what are those communication protocols that are helping, let's say hardware level or application level, that are helping these in order to initiate at least. So you have Bluetooth, Bluetooth low energy, I mean, I think I've not mentioned here. So Bluetooth, you have Z-Wave, you have Zigbee, you have Sigfox, you have Wi-Fi, 4G, you have LoRa. I think even LoRa is not mentioned here. Yeah, it's there. So you have all these protocols based on there. So whenever you try to have... I hope there is not any shaking with your system. I think it would be clear, right? Which screen are you able to seeing now? Yeah. Okay. So yeah. So now I think it's gonna be fine now. So based on their power requirement, data rate, and range, you have these protocols. So whenever you try to implement these things, or whenever you try to implement a solution, there's always a trade-off. So that means you have a range to consider about. You have data rate, and you have power consumption. So when you want to have data rate, high data rate, also you want to have range, so you will have more power requirement. For example, your 4G or Wi-Fi. If you want to restrict your data rate, you want to have long range and less power requirement, you will use LoRa, Sigfox, things like that. And even BLE, Bluetooth low energy, which is like almost like 900 meter with a small, let's say good payload also. I mean, you can transfer good payload, but also less power. And you have, if you want, let's say less range, but more data, so you will have more power consumption, just like your Wi-Fi or somewhere towards your also 4G or 3G.
For less range, but more data.
Of course, I can do that. What is that? Yeah, I think it's okay now. Is it good? Is it good now? Yeah, okay. So you can see the chart. So there's always a trade-off between what kind of the data you're trying to send. So for example, I mean, now I'll tell you and you can suggest me the protocol. So I want high data rate, let's say, because I have, I'll talk about the application. You need to talk about which protocol or which network layer or which device will you use, okay? So I need to transfer the data of for webcam. So which protocol or which connection would you use in among this protocol existing?
Bluetooth and...
No, I mean, not in TCP or UDP, but there's a communication protocol, let's say this Wi-Fi or hardware layer, basically abstraction layers, I can say. Yeah, someone says Wi-Fi, can I have more solutions? LTE.
So can you please repeat the question once again?
Yeah. But can you transfer LTE, can you transfer video on LTE CAT?
Hello?
You have 4G, 4G Lite, yes. Yes, you can use that. That's a good one. That's more of a independent solution. So you with Wi-Fi, you need not to have a router. So I think 4G Lite would be a good one. We need Volt, yeah, voice over LTE. It's voice over, so it's like IP based call. But to implement that, you need 3G or 4G. Yeah, okay. I think no one would agree that we will use Bluetooth. Have you ever seen using Bluetooth for transferring video, right? So I have a application which is irrigation. So which protocol among this or Wi-Fi or connections will you use? Will you use ZigBee? Will you use Bluetooth? Will you use LoRa? Which one would you use?
So please repeat the question once again.
Someone says ZigBee. ZigBee is just like 200 or 250 meter protocol. At the maximum speed and maximum range is 250. So you can see in the ZigBee, you have just 100 meter range. But irrigation, it's like you have big, you have hectares of land. So you have like 10, 20 hectares of land. So what data can you transfer from irrigation site? What maximum data can you transfer? Water level, maybe moisture, maybe temperature, maybe anything like that. So like, let's say small data rate. So the application is irrigation. So which protocol would you use? Which implementation would you choose? Someone says ZigBee or LoRa. I would agree for LoRa, but not ZigBee, because the range is very small. But LoRa range is like 1 kilometer somewhere. And if you use LoRaWAN, if you go with LoRaWAN, you can transfer almost like 10 kilometers in a line of sight. According to application, I'll go with NRF. NRF. So NRF with what? Okay, 2.4 gigahertz, but yeah, I think you can use that, but I think hello everyone, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just a second. Yeah. So I was talking about irrigation. So yeah, so there was some power cut. So someone please who when goes into electricity department, kindly make sure that we don't have power cut someday. Okay, so talking about irrigation level, so I think LoRa would be the best solution for that, as for me. Now moving forward about choosing the best hardware about your regarding your application. There are existing hardware, for example, you have in end devices, you have Arduino. There are different variants of Arduino. You can use them based on your customized requirement. And of course, so when you have different variants of Arduino, you definitely have some variance in your flash memory, ability to communicate with different devices and number of pins and things like that. And now how would you be able to choose which microcontroller would be good? And this is just about Arduino. There are like many devices. Let's say you have board from Particle IO company that basically has just one board and it has solution for GPS, GPRS. And it also has 3G, it also has Wi-Fi connectivity. So there are many companies that are implementing these protocols like one device and then it has everything. Even you have NodeMCU, if you might have heard of it, it has Wi-Fi capabilities along with roughly kind of in same similar interface with Arduino. And then you have custom another kind of like different type of it. So you have battery powered round shape. You can customize it as per your need. You can just dismantle everything from Arduino since it's open source. You can make it of your own also. Okay. Now, as a comparison, you have, let's say, if your device does not need much of interface, let's say you only have, you have LilyPad also that was before. So if your device, there's not much to interface with Arduino, you can use less number of pins. For example, you have a number of analog pins, 6, and the least one could be 0 Tian, and DC IO is 7. So I think one of the board that you can shortlist is your Tian and your this one, MO Pro, okay? And you also have to look that it takes less power. So let's see if they are good in less power. So, so here you can see this Tian board consumes how much power can you see? Yeah, operating voltage you have 5 volt and it's good. It's good enough. So digital IO pins you have 20. The least digital pins could be industrial 101.7. And fine, this could be, we can shortlist. And the number of RAM, the amount of RAM is 64 kilobytes. Flash RAM is 16 kilobytes, I think. 16,000 kilobytes. So 16 MB, I guess. I think it's good enough. So if you need something like less interface for your irrigation type of problem, so I think you can shortlist industrial 101. And you need to integrate this. Does it have Wi-Fi? Let's check. It has Wi-Fi on one. So this industry 101 has Ethernet and Wi-Fi capability. So that means for irrigation type of problem, this would be the best board since you have Wi-Fi. But you also have to know that you cannot use Wi-Fi for irrigation type of problem. That means what you can do is you can choose off another board which it has possibility with interacting with GSM or LoRa, and you can use the voice pop. So based on that, you can pop digital LiPo pins, you have MKR, 3.3 volts, in digital pin, you have less memory, so if you consume less memory, you have only one thing to do that. So you have also SRAM, length of it is 64 millimeters. You have width, less width, you have micro SD and Wi-Fi. So that means based on your requirement, how much power you need, how much digital pins you would need, you can shortlist the board of it based on your requirements. You can have a screenshot quickly if you want to have. But anyway, you will be having the presentation and also you will have When you join the class, you will also have access to this presentation. And this presentation, I want to talk about Ankia won't work again because operating voltage for small motors will be 5 volts. Operating voltage for MKR is 3.3 volts. And if you want to have your, let's say your soil sensor could be less power consuming. Yep. So you can use extra battery maybe, because anyway, the minimum requirement operating voltage is 3.3. So you can always have more power. So that's completely fine. So you can always have extra battery. You can provide, let's say, extra electronic system, wherein some of the power of 5 volts you can give to your soil sensor. Is my voice not clear properly? Okay, so based on your, let's say if you need 5 volts, you can always have an electronic circuit that has 5 volts and also 3.3, and you can make them run forever, okay? Now, in this slide, I want to talk about different combination of sensors. Someone says, which one is good for making smart home system? Which one? The protocol. As far as like ZigBee is concerned, ZigBee is the best one because people usually, Z-Wave is the most preferred home automation protocol. Because of this, it's optimized for home-based automation, let's say small distance and different aspects of it. So usually though, there are companies in Bangalore who are specifically asking me to train them for Z-Wave. So there are like different constants in order to control Z-Wave. But you can also use ZigBee, you can also use the Bluetooth since your distance in home is not much 10 meters, but since if you talk about multi-story buildings, multi-story home, yes, of course you would need a ZigBee. So it has like 200 meters. It can take much, let's say Z-Wave, it can take many connections as possible. Let's say like 100, I think many connections that can take to communicate. Okay. Now with the help of IR sensor or with the help of light sensor, you can actually try to make a street light type of automation. So you have smart street light. That's very good. So whenever you go on a highway, sometimes you don't have power because now the government is implementing solar power based smart lights, but they also need to have sensors in order to make dim and dark light. So I think you might have heard that Delhi government is making smart street lights. It has property for dim neighbors. It can sharpen your view and things like that. But then it's very basic solution. And the only reason now they're banning about much is it's almost like someone just controlled it, some made a prototype and then sold them for scale-up process. So you can also do that and propose. If you can, but just if you come on board and work with me, if you have a solution, you can provide something LED control and dimmable LEDs. Uttarakhand still don't have dimmable LED streetlights. So you can propose the government. And of course, since I can also help you in proposing through me. Okay, so we can always have this discussion. And if you use flow meter along with this, along with IR sensor, you can actually control your water tap, the amount of water that is flowing in your water tap. This is kind of an application that you can build by using these three sensors. Flow meter, you have two types of flow meter. You can use based on your requirement. And of course, you need battery. You can need relays in order to control and automate that. And you need Arduino or some kind of device. You can, since it's Arduino, it's open source. You can just take down and tear down the parts and then make custom yourself. And you can make a product like that for your home. And this would do something like that. Of course, you can hide the back part of it in the wall. Dig the hole. I mean, don't destroy your home wall. Try to do that as a side project, like make a box. So you can hide this black part and you can just show this water tap. Okay, so you have this sensor also at the left, you can see. So whenever someone puts his hand, the water flows out, and whenever someone pulls his hand, the water stops. It's a basic solution, but it will help you impact the real world. Okay, and the good thing about implementing such project is by the time your placements come, you propose yourself to companies, you can actually show a cloud solution of the data or data visualization and show that, you know what, I'm implementing it everywhere in my home. So I'm controlling every tap of my every water of my tap, and visualizing the amount of data, amount of water being flown by using flow meter, and this is how the visualization is. So you are able to implement end-to-end solution by using just simple use case. Okay. With the help of a speed sensor, you can measure the speed of a motor, or you can measure the speed of a car. You can make something like this adjustment, and this is your motor. Right here, you have your speed sensor at the bottom, and you have this car wheel, and you can also monitor the speed of the car and then alert someone or send an alert message to your phone if the speed crosses a certain limit. So simple operation, but then yet bigger impact. Okay. So I have taken much of time in talking in depth about IoT and Zigbee and protocols in depth. So maybe in this scope of 2 hours, I may not be able to show you a live demo of implementing IoT with AWS, but I can still show you and talk about how can it be implemented, so that we have a lot of time to talk about the industrial requirements, or how to present yourself to industries, how can you find your next job in IoT, what this course is all about. You can also talk about how much, let's say, if you have any doubts about IoT, if you have any doubt about the course content, so we can keep that time for that. Okay. So the next part of this is about connecting with cloud services. With MQTT, this MQTT or HTTP or EMQTT is nothing but your data protocol that helps you send the data in certain format. All you need is just an API that interacts with this website or web, let's say cloud services, and also your end device. But then, since we have discussed that there is a 3 layers that have been implemented, which is your edge, you have cloud, you have fog. So you can't really just send the data to the cloud directly. Why? Because imagine that you have some kind of video data that you are trying to send the data on cloud. First of all, if you let's say you're transmitting a live, or you're transmitting all the megabits, let's say thousands and then GB of data, that means you will naturally increase your cost of operation, and none of your clients will be interested to pay you bulk amount just for implementing your IoT kind of data, let's say video conferencing or smart surveillance system. Government is always restricted on budget. So you have to also keep in mind that you cannot just throw the data on cloud. Second, and I would rather keep these two issues in parallel, that whenever you transmit or give the capability of connecting anything on internet, you also invite hackers saying that, you know what, I open challenge you, this is the device that has been connected over internet, and anything on internet is vulnerable to devices. No matter how much security expert, how good security expert you hire, there is always a possibility to hack such system. Once it is hacked, they can bring down all your system that has been scaled up to zero. So that means, imagine you took years of it, let's say you took 3 years to implement all over India your smart surveillance, and there is one mad cyber, let's say, hacker who comes and shut down all the system and destroy everything, gone. So you have like tons of crores being spent, you know, to just make your system vulnerable. So what you do is, you basically, there's something called AWS Greengrass, and there's something called a digital twin, with the help of which you can make all your stuff, let's say report or analysis, data cleaning, machine learning pipeline, and things like that in your fog devices. You can have, let's say, powerful board, let's say IoT Intel Edison, or Jetson Nano, or BeagleBone, much powerful boards like that. And you can process the data almost at the client side. And you can just clean the data, perform analysis, monitor the data. All you need to do is you can just send the data on the cloud, which is only about the number of devices that was active, the number of that their minimum requirement, the maximum power, and things like that. And the person who is ahead of it can have just monitoring. And the good way you can use cloud is for controlling or performing batch operation. That means if for some reason your client doesn't agree to give you paycheck of next month, or maybe you have your bond being cut from next month or next day, with the help of cloud services, you can just click disable or delete the devices, and in a second, all the devices, even thousands, deployed at the client side will stop acting right away. So it's all based on you always have a control whenever you employ cloud, more like administration or like holding purpose. Okay, so this is how I suggest you can use cloud for, and make your much of your data and representation of cleaning as a fog device rather than in the cloud directly. And a basic implementation of AWS IoT can be seen in this diagram, where you have end devices, which is transferring the data. You have gateways. You can convert your Raspberry Pi as a gateway also. You have your network routers, like this Wi-Fi kind of routers. And you can transmit the data over network server. You have AWS integration, IoT integration. You have registry. You can register your devices. You have rules, engines. So it helps you basically segregate which topic should go where and which topic should go where. With the help of rules engine, with the help of other services of AWS IoT, which is in this time constant, I won't be able to list all of them. But then surely when you come, you will have AWS IoT as default, de facto, to be covered in the code. So with the help of it, you can segregate the topic, you can make the connection secure. MQTT on AWS is only to QoS 1, and you can store the message, you can perform Lambda functions, let's say some anomalies. You can store it for log purpose, you can store it for analysis by using QuickSight of AWS service, and you can perform your end-to-end solution by using AWS. Someone says cloud services are not free. Yes, but let's say cloud AWS gives a lot of services as free. So let's say 500 GB of data, or let's say 10,000 hits per month, we give it for free. And this makes someone a little bit of kind of a greedy, that we have a lot of things free, just scale up the system and send it on cloud. And that's where everyone gets tied up, and then you have amount to give. Okay. And that's a business plan of AWS, so that's fine. So kind of give brief overview about kind of questions that are in interviews, taking into consideration that the presentation technical. I'll surely give that. So let's move to the last part of it. I hope you have understood from basics of it. Abhay, I wish I could give practical demonstration of IoT. Since the time is restricted, I may not be able to give, but I think there is a small implementation. But then implementing that, by the time you guys download that app, it will be already like after 12, and I already have some session or class to take at 2. So I apologize that I won't be able to show live demo. But sure, if for some reason you feel like, sir, maybe just can you give a live demo, a class or a webinar which just shows the live demo? Just ask Brilika, and then we can have like 30 minutes or 15 minutes of webinar. So you can just do that definitely. And can we integrate other cloud with other cloud services other than AWS? Yes. You have GCP, which is Google Cloud Platform. You have Azure. You have AWS. You have ThingWorks. The main competitors are Azure and AWS. And Sanath, I'll come to your question, which is the next part of this slide, talking about industries and getting your first job. So let's have a quick overview, or let's have a quick talk. Have you guys understood so far about the protocols or AWS? How many of you feel like, yes, I've understood and this webinar was beneficial for you? Let's have hashtag, kind of let's make it trending in this webinar, like we have in previous. Let's say, let's keep it hashtag iShield. Let's make it trending in this webinar. Hashtag iShield, if you have gained or felt this webinar was beneficial for you. I can give you how the format should be. So it's #IE. Okay, so this is, if you feel this webinar was beneficial for you, you gained some insights, put that AWS, I mean, #IT. Kindly brief about AWS IT. I actually, it was disconnected for a while. Yeah, so yeah, I'll talk about that. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We need at least 30. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, don't repeat, 18, 19, 20, 21. We need 30 at least. 22, 23, 24, Pragya. 30, let's make it 30 at least. 24. Others, don't you feel like you have gained real insight of it? We have 24, we need 6 more. Vishal, don't repeat, that's it. Okay, I think it's me. So 25, 26, 4 more. Unique, not repeated. Yeah, 1, 2, 1 more, 2 more. Okay, that's completely fine. So at least we have 50%, somewhere like 45% at least. 28 is like roughly 56, half of 56. Okay, so now let's talk about the main part of it, the last slide of it. Industry, those are implementing and opportunity. So now I'm going to talk about the AWS IoT part. So let's have a doubt session now. So AWS IoT basically has some, let's say you have end device, you have gateways, you have network servers and try to implement the IoT by using some device rule engine. And you try to store data in S3 bucket. You can perform Lambda functions in order to save the data or perform some operation on data. You can store in buckets and integrate with QuickSight of AWS in order to provide data analytics. So that's how you can use AWS and perform your own. So in your course, we will be using 3 services of AWS and try to implement how to use to send IoT security data over internet or AWS. Okay, and you are free to post your questions here. What are the major advantages of AWS? The big tech giant, first of all, everything is already installed. The platform is ready to be scaled up. It's cheap compared to Azure. It's free. Anyone can get started with it. Yeah, but since I'm not part of AWS, I would say Azure is also good, but the learning curve or the starting is a bit like you need to have a credit card in order to get started with Azure. What are the AWS services that will be used, that will be using in, that we will be using in AWS? We will be implementing a trust problem use case. We will be performing analytics. So QuickSight, your S3 bucket, Lambda function, and you will also have AWS IoT, AWS IoT core. And I'll also give you a brief overview about AWS Greengrass. I'm interested in backend portion, coding and other stuff. Is it necessary to learn the front end also? No. So that can be given as a solution where, let's say, if you want to get into, if you're from electronic background, if you want to get into IoT company, I would suggest master the skill of programming or Arduino, C and Python. Get into IoT, keep learning IoT and AWS and IoT, and start to upgrade yourself, and then after 2-3 years, apply for IoT engineer or IoT, let's say, backend programmer. Because at first, if I have to hire you as an IoT engineer, I need to evaluate your experience. That are you able to implement the scale-up big project of IoT? Because in order to propose a solution to a client, you need to also propose the device that you're going to use. You also need to have hands-on experience with existing devices that helps you give 3D, GPS, and GPRS. You also need to have battery requirement in your mind. You also need to have, let's say, how can you make a device work on for 10 years without the use of that external supply. So there are a lot of things. So you need to have experience and embedded and little bit closer interaction with IoT devices, IoT companies. Will we use Arduino or any other advanced board? We will use Arduino Uno, or maybe I'll propose one of the Arduino board which is recently launched that has Wi-Fi, and it also has GPS and BLE also. Yeah, so most probably we'll be using NodeMCU for Wi-Fi connection. We'll be using that. Could you suggest any resources that are good in your opinion, or which you have experience for upgrading ourselves in this domain? First of all, I think not many have made this IoT as, like, they come here and yeah, there are like good blogs. Let's say there is a company called blog like IoT for All. You can have a quick insight of that quote. And whenever, let's say, you can just learn about technology. But in order to implement things, you always need someone, or let's say hard, let's say you need to go inside of it to how to implement and scale the product for different devices. So here whenever we are learning MQTT or IoT, I'll be focusing on MQTT so that we have mastered MQTT protocol rather than knowing every protocol in depth of it. It's just like knowing everything, but you don't have implementation level of experience in any of the protocol. But I'll be explaining you about other protocols and it's, and I'll be also explaining you what other personal projects that we and me personally is working with. So you can definitely be a part of it if you're interested with it, which is not only MQTT, but also other protocols. Anything, any question that you have? So everything about this, we will be discussing in our class. There is a pattern that we are following from now on, that whenever you join the class, you will be taken up, let's say, you will have to submit a report of end-to-end IoT implementation under my guidance, and you need to submit that as a report. I'll be a reviewer and say you that what are the requirements or what are the things. And also during this, I'll be helping you how to suggest or how to select parts based on IoT requirements that can be used in industry. Okay, so that's a unique way we are in Relica, we are trying to teach students about IoT. So through this, we'll master IoT and MQTT protocol. Okay. When will the class commence? As soon as we form a batch, and as soon as we have possibility to transfer the kit, because you know that there is a lockdown, and so we need to take care of that. But starting our next batches, as per my knowledge, is starting from 20th of June. So it's better to have, you can contact Relica in order to enroll yourself. So the next batch is starting from 20th June. And don't worry about that. I have taught those who are actually working in industries. Hopefully, if you implement with me and if you show experience, if you show maturity, if you show your continuous learning, and maybe I will be able to refer you to some companies, but not directly. Let's say go and your job is done. But yeah, I can maybe talk about that. You know what? These are the people who are good at it. And there are a lot of good things that we are developing, and we have in project pipeline, which you, if you have a knowledge of web development, you can be a part of it, a little bit of also. And you can help other aspiring IoT engineers to make their profile boost by coming and helping my platform to what I'm working on. So you will also gain quite a bit. And the only thing that I have experienced in my experience I've seen is it doesn't matter which course you have done, it doesn't matter which training institute you have worked with, it doesn't matter which degree certificate you have, all it matters is if you have experience. There is no beat down to experience. So if you come, for sure you will have experience, so you can always talk about that. And also you have, let's say, like project, of course you have certification of IBM, of course. But then you will also gain the insights of how to work on a scale-up project. Maybe you have something to suggest, so you can make it live. I'll make my repository live or open source, or maybe I'll invite you to integrate with GitHub of my repository and make that project so you can always scale up that project to industry level. Okay. How can we gain our experience regarding IoT? Come take up the course, join with me. Even if the course is completed, you still work with me for at least like 3 to 4 months and try to implement the complete end-to-end solution, or try to implement let's say end-to-end use case study. So I will be helping you in an initial framing of the problem, giving you the case studies that are available online. Although people have given white papers, the case studies, we as a team will be implementing those papers in our experience. So you can always, I'll initialize the GitHub repository. I'll help you initialize that project, and then you can scale up based on the different requirements. And during this, if you're interested, I'll help you know how to work with GitHub. So you work as a team and you take certain part of it and then integrate and together work and scale up that project, use case study, okay? Something about the content of the course, you can definitely talk about this with Brilliqa. I don't have this right away, but yeah, it consists of AWS. We will implement MQTT use case study, and the boards that we'll be using is Raspberry Pi and NodeMCU. Yeah. And sometimes I also get some project requirements. Let's say recently I had a project that someone needed to propose about IoT and case for fleet management. Fleet management is brought about tracking vehicles. So I had a project like that. So any doubts, anything that you wish to ask? I hope this webinar has excited you or maybe given you positive hope about possibilities. And of course, there are many, of course. Yeah, I'm there on GitHub. You can find me on by the name Sharik. So you can always ask. There is always like there is on the website of Brilliqa. You can always there's our contact details. I forgot to mention our website, but it's Brilliqa Services, Brilliqa.com. Yeah, Brilliqa Services.com. And you can have a review about my profile. And there is also I can just share my LinkedIn where you can check about me or other people, and www.linkedin.com /IM/Sharik. And you also have, you can visit Brilliqa Services.com for further information or the information about the team that is working about this webinar. Brilliqa Services.com, I hope you can get that. So feel free to share your insights about this webinar. You can tag me in your post, you can tag Brilliqa Services, you can tag Mr. Yogendra, which is primarily, and Ms. Pooja, which is primarily responsible for this webinar. We three of us, and then there are other teams also. You're free to tag us and share your thoughts on the LinkedIn. So it also will be boost about the profile. So if we make any type of automation system or automation, then cost of this will be increased. So what should we do about this? the flow meter is the cost of implementing that water management is hardly, if you after the kit that you've been that is been given by, you hardly need to put maximum 1,000 rupees, maximum 1,000, not more than that. How to get the course? You will get a call from Liquor Services. You can definitely talk to them about the payments and everything. How to get to the course? Visit Liquor Services, or visit this website info at Liquor Services, and you will also get a follow-up call from Relica, one of the consultants. She's working from quite a long time. So Miss Rina or Miss Lida or someone, you will get a call from them, and they will be getting in touch with you because they